Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Abraham Lincoln, A Life, by Michael Burlingame. An election victory, threats of secession, and appointing a cabinet. May 1860 to 1861. Read by Sean Pratt.
Chapter 16. I have been elected mainly on the cry, Honest Old Abe. The Presidential Campaign, May to November, 1860. Shortly after the Chicago Convention, Joshua Giddings assured Lincoln with certain knowledge, "But your selection was made upon two grounds. First, that you are an honest man, and second, that you are not in the hands of corrupt or dishonest men." Seward suffered by contrast, and some of the senator's backers acknowledged that they must not blame the people of the United States for being afraid that the election of a leading New York politician to the presidency would only displace the existing corruption at Washington by a new importation of venality and political knavery from Albany. A New York delegate, former Lieutenant Governor Henry R. Selden, declared that all the forces working against Seward would have been insufficient to defeat him had not his opponents strengthened their arguments by allusion to the corruptions practiced at Albany during the past winter. No man entertained the idea that Mr. Seward was connected with them, but it was charged that his friends were, and it was pretended that if elected, the same practices would be transmitted to Washington. Hostility to corruption not only contributed to Lincoln's nomination in May, but it also helped clinch his victory in November. The public was fed up with steamship lobbies, land-grant bribery, hireling journalists, the spoils system, rigged political conventions, and cost overruns on government projects. At a New York ratification meeting, Horace Greeley introduced a resolution proclaiming that there were two irrepressible conflicts, one pitting freedom against slavery, and the other, not less vital, between frugal government and honest administration on the one hand, and wholesale executive corruption and speculative jobbery on the other. Along with several other newspapers, the Cincinnati Commercial predicted that a Lincoln administration would be honest, economical, and capable. William Cullen Bryant pledged that his New York Evening Post would do all it could to turn out the present most corrupt of administrations and install an honest administration in its stead. New Englanders stressed the corruption issue. Samuel Bowles of the Springfield, Massachusetts Republican accurately prophesied that on an issue likely to rival, if not to overshadow, that of the irrepressible Negro, that of honesty, simplicity, and economy in public affairs, Lincoln would run well, for honest old Abe will mean something serious, as well as prove a taking campaign cry. Emphatically, the Concord, New Hampshire statesman argued that Lincoln's lack of national political experience was an element of strength, for it meant that he had not succumbed to the gross corruption so prevalent at Washington.
"The nation is suffering for a want of an incorruptible chief magistrate,
a man who will indignantly crush out and drive into perpetual exile the inexorable army of bloodsuckers that hang around the Democratic camp at Washington. This troop is legion, and hovering over the treasury like Cossacks in the rear of the French army on its retreat from Moscow. A change cannot be for the worse, and may be for the better. Then let us have a change. Abraham Lincoln is honest, capable, and friendly to the Constitution. Let us put him in as president, and drive all the treasury rats away." In Connecticut, the Hartford Courant declared that one of the strongest arguments in favor of the election of Lincoln to the presidency is his honesty and old-fashioned integrity and firmness.
"The people all want the government administrated with integrity and economy.
We have tried two dishonest administrations of the Democratic Party. Let us try them no longer, but place the government in the hands of uncorrupted and uncorruptible men." After winning the presidency, Lincoln told a visitor, All through the campaign, my friends have been calling me Honest Old Abe, and I have been elected mainly on that cry. His reputation as an honest man was as important as his reputation as a foe of slavery. National reaction. As word of Lincoln's nomination spread throughout the North, jubilant Republicans set off fireworks, rang bells, ignited bonfires, illuminated buildings, erected rail fences, paraded by torchlight, cheered speakers, and fired cannons with the same high spirits that had characterized the boisterously successful Harrison campaign of 1840.
An Illinois delegate freshly returned from the Chicago convention predicted accurately that the coming campaign will not be a whit behind that of 1840 in point of enthusiasm.
There was, in fact, a great deal of hoopla in the canvass, provided largely by rail splitter and wide awake organizations, which led countless demonstrations. Wide awakes, a group of young Republican activists, made their debut in Connecticut that spring during the gubernatorial campaign. They were best known for nighttime parades, during which they carried tin torches on poles, which they deemed rails. Lincoln himself said he was not particularly fond of show and parade, and personally did not care much for such demonstrations. Though he acknowledged that the organizations were useful in turning out crowds for speakers and in providing opportunities for partisans to take an active role in the campaign. "Principle composed only about 10% of our political contests," he told a New Yorker. Sharing Lincoln's aversion to hoopla was New York attorney George Templeton Strong, who eventually voted for Lincoln, though not enthusiastically. A month after the convention, he confided to his diary, "I am tired of this shameless claptrap. The log cabin hard cider craze of 1840 seemed spontaneous. This hurrah about rails and rail splitters seems a deliberate attempt to manufacture the same kind of furor by appealing to the shallowest prejudices of the lowest class." Fellow New Yorker Hamilton Fish agreed, sarcastically exclaiming, "Hurrah for Lincoln and Hamlin! We want a log splitter, not a hair splitter. A flat boatman, not a flat statesman. Log cabin, coon skins, hard cider, Old Abe and dark ham, hurrah!" In Washington, Republican members of Congress received the news from Chicago with great enthusiasm. Senator William P. Fessenden of Maine, who had favored Ben Wade of Ohio for the presidency, reported that Lincoln's nomination surprised us all, but on the whole has given general satisfaction to the Republicans and frightened the Democrats. Wade himself said, "We are all safe if Old Abe is on the track." A representative from Wade's state was reminded of a traveler in the Southwest who once asked a black man how distant a certain town was. "Well, sir," came the answer, "with an ordinary horse, it am about 16 mile. With a right smart nag, it'll be about 8 mile. But with Massa Jim's horse, you dare now." Said the congressman, "So with Seward, we should have had a hard road to travel. With Ben Wade, we should have been pretty sure of winning the race, having no dead weights. But with Honest Old Abe, we're there now." Congressman Charles Francis Adams, who thought Seward deserved the nomination, expressed reservations about Lincoln. "I believe him honest and tolerably capable," he wrote, "but he has no experience and no business habits." Yet, Adams noted, many of his Republican colleagues in the House seemed delighted. Because all Republican factions could unite behind Lincoln, the party enjoyed a huge advantage over its badly divided rivals. Already the candidacy of the cold, reserved, colorless 64-year-old Tennessee slaveholder and former Senator John Bell, standard-bearer of the new Constitutional Union Party, comprised mostly of Southern ex-Whigs, had weakened Democrats in the Upper South. He was to win his own state plus Kentucky and Virginia. When in June the Democratic National Convention reassembled in Baltimore,
Northern and Southern delegates continued the bitter fight that had begun at Charleston.
Utterly unable to compromise, each section nominated its own candidate. Douglas won the endorsement of the Northern Democrats, while Vice President John C. Breckinridge of Kentucky became the choice of the Southerners. With his opposition now backing three different candidates, Lincoln appeared to have an excellent chance. Lincoln confidently believed that the Democrats could not reunite. He said their predicament reminded him of a story. "I once knew a good, sound churchman, whom we'll call Brown, who was on a committee to erect a bridge over a very dangerous and rapid river. Architect after architect failed, and at last Brown said he had a friend named Jones, who had built several bridges and could build this. 'Let's have him in,' said the committee. In came Jones. 'Can you build this bridge, sir?' 'Yes,' replied Jones. 'I could build a bridge to the infernal regions if necessary.' The sober committee were horrified, but when Jones retired, Brown thought it but fair to defend his friend. 'I know Jones so well,' he said, 'and he is so honest a man and so good an architect that, if he states soberly and positively that he can build a bridge to Hades, why, I believe it. But I have my doubts about the abutment on the infernal side.' So when politicians said they could harmonize the northern and southern wings of the democracy, why, I believed them. But I had my doubts about the abutment on the southern side." Republican newspapers rejoiced at the nomination of such an appealing and unblemished candidate. One called him, "Just the man that this sorely swindled and disgraced nation needs for president, for Lincoln is a man of stainless purity. His whole life is as spotless as the driven snow. He is no corruptionist, no trickster, no time server, but an honest, brave, straightforward, able man who will restore the government to the purity of practice and principle which characterized its early days under the administrations of the revolutionary patriots." A pro-Seward journal assured its readers that Lincoln was no expediency candidate, but one who early embraced the Republican cause, who has always labored consistently for its success, has, from the beginning, stood and stands now fair and square on its national and conservative platform.
It was a cause for celebration that a candidate is fixed upon who has so many recommendations as Abraham Lincoln,
whose character embraces so many excellent qualities, and whose personal history gives him so strong a hold on the goodwill of the people.
He would attract voters who float loosely between the two parties.
The convention had wisely picked two candidates fresh from the people, of broad and statesmanlike qualities, of unquestioned abilities, and of tried patriotism. Northern Democrats countered that the platform and the head of the ticket are a shrewdly disguised abolition Whig move. Lincoln was, they sneered,
"an obscure lawyer, confessedly lacking in culture and capacity, which are requisite to the creditable occupancy of the high office for which he has been nominated.
An extreme abolitionist of the revolutionary type, a weak and unfit man for so high a place, a third-rate country lawyer, an uneducated man, a vulgar village politician, without any experience worth mentioning in the practical duties of statesmanship, a fourth-rate lecturer who cannot speak good grammar, a man whose only merit consists in splitting rails or splitting the sides of a village audience with his smutty stories, an obscure partisan, a bigot and extremist, and an honest, well-meaning man of less than average mental caliber, who is almost a monomaniac on the subject of negro slavery, and who is brimful of nigger." What the Republicans applauded as Lincoln's freshness, the Democrats denounced as an appalling lack of credentials. The Philadelphia Evening Journal complained that his record as a statesman is blank. "He has done nothing whatever in any executive, judicial, or legislative capacity that should entitle him to public respect." In the opinion of a former colleague in the Illinois Whig Party, Lincoln's experience was "only that which has been acquired in the worst governed state in the Union, he himself being identified with its worst blunders and follies." Another former ally, Benjamin S. Edwards, publicly asked, What had Lincoln ever done to stamp him as a statesman worthy to be at the head of a great nation like ours? The Albany Atlas and Argus chastise the Republicans for nominating an obscure man who represents no principle and no sentiment except hostility to Seward. Above all, Democrats objected to Lincoln as an anti-slavery radical. Politically, he is as rabid an abolitionist as John Brown himself, but without the old man's courage, jeered the New York Herald. Citing Lincoln's 1837 vote against a resolution condemning abolitionists and his protest stating that slavery was based on injustice and bad policy, the Illinois State Register said, "He is as much an abolitionist as are William Lloyd Garrison, Gerrit Smith, or Wendell Phillips." Democratic Congressman Charles Drake Martin of Ohio called Lincoln the originator of a treasonable heresy, the irrepressible conflict doctrine. Don Morrison of Illinois condemned him as a Kentucky abolitionist, infinitely worse than a Yankee abolitionist. To illustrate the candidate's devotion to the doctrine of racial equality, Morrison quoted passages from his Chicago speech of July 10, 1858. Here are three examples. "I should like to know if taking this old Declaration of Independence, which declares that all men are equal upon principle and making exceptions to it where it will stop. If one man says it does not mean a negro, why not another say it does not mean some other man? If that declaration is not the truth, let us get the statute book, in which we find it, and tear it out. Let us discard all this quibbling about this man and the other man, this race and that race and the other race being inferior, and therefore they must be placed in an inferior position, discarding our standard that we have left us. Let us discard all these things, and unite as one people throughout this land, until we shall once more stand up declaring that all men are created equal. I thank you for this most extensive audience you have furnished me tonight. I leave you, hoping that the lamp of liberty will burn in your bosoms, and here there shall be no longer a doubt that all men are created free and equal." Democrats also cited passages from Lincoln's 1854 Peoria address. "What I do say is that no man is good enough to govern another man without the other's consent. I say this is the leading principle, the sheet anchor of republicanism." I have quoted so much at this time merely to show that according to our ancient faith, the just powers of governments are derived from the consent of the governed. Now the relation of slave and master is pro rata a total violation of this principle. The master not only governs the slave without his consent, but he governs him by a set of rules altogether different from those which he prescribes for himself. Allow all the governed an equal voice in the government, and that only, is self-government. In what speech of Seward are such violent sentiments as these set forth? Asked the correspondent of the New York Herald. Where can anything be found to exceed them in the ferocious abolitionism of Phillips or Garrison? Democratic papers repeatedly cited Lincoln's House Divided speech and his 1854 Peoria address to prove that he was as devoted to the extermination of slavery as any abolitionist. They even falsely ascribed to him an 1856 speech calling for black suffrage in Illinois. As further proof of Lincoln's radicalism, it was alleged that he had subscribed funds to help John Brown in Kansas. Lincoln had signed a document pledging financial aid to the peaceful inhabitants of Kansas who were being attacked by Missouri border ruffians. The money was never collected. The bitterest denunciations of Lincoln were flagrantly racist. John Cochran of New York declared that the Republican standard-bearer and his party engrafted negrology onto their political stock, producing thereby its natural fruit, nigger, the eternal nigger. They ate nigger, they drank nigger, they, at least the amalgamationists, slept nigger. They saw him in their dreams, they saw him in their waking hours, All over, everywhere, they saw the sable gentleman. As for the choice of Lincoln, when nominating a rail splitter for the presidency, they were really resolved that they saw a nigger in the fence. The Illinois State Register claimed that if Lincoln won, we shall have the nigger at the polls, the nigger on our juries, the nigger in the legislature. The Cleveland campaign plane dealer agreed. Give black republicanism the power, and they will leave no effort spared to reach that practical equality of all men, which Mr. Lincoln tells us is the great central idea to be labored for. Successful, we shall have the nigger at the polls, the nigger on our juries, the nigger in the legislature, in our public offices, and, with political power, it is but one step, with those who think with them, to concede them that social position which will realize the central idea of a common mulattodom. In an attempt to undermine Lincoln's reputation for integrity, the Chicago Times accused him of illegally billing the federal government for 3 pairs of boots while he served in Congress. The charge was refuted by Josiah M. Lucas, Lincoln's friend who was serving as the postmaster of the U.S. House and had access to the expense records of the 30th Congress. Southern Democrats were even more contemptuous than their Northern counterparts, calling Lincoln the nominee of a free filth and wool-gathering convention, a recreant son of the South, a traitor to the mother that bore him, a nigger in principle, coarse, vulgar, and uneducated, a mere politician of small caliber, and a third-rate Western lawyer. A former governor of South Carolina told his wife that the Republicans have selected a wretched backwoodsman who have cleverness indeed but no cultivation, who is a fanatic in his policy and an agrarian in his practice. Nothing but ruin can follow in his trail. The Missouri Republican asserted that Lincoln's nomination meant that the irrepressible conflict between the free and the slave states is to be kept up until the free states drive slavery out of all the slave states. A letter in that paper charged that Lincoln appears to think the only mission of the white man is to rescue by any means the Negro from bondage. The doctrine of the entire and complete equality of races has been believed and proclaimed by him long, long before the rise of the Republican Party. Although members of that party hesitated to commit themselves to racial equality openly, Lincoln understood that they must and would, whenever they deemed they had sufficient strength, not only proclaim, but put into practical action that radical doctrine. Lincoln was a much more dangerous man than Mr. Seward, for he lacked the sense and intellect of Mr. Seward. Nor yet is he as wily or as politic as Seward. He is not such a statesman as Seward, nor has he Seward's suavity of manners nor breeding.
Nor is he as well versed in the practical working of our complex government.
Nor does he know just as well how far to go with safety, nor when to relax, lest the attention becoming too great, the cord should snap. But he has all of Seward's sectional ideas, and even more, and if in power, would inevitably press them to their utmost. Southerners made dire predictions about the future under a Republican regime.
As soon as Lincoln is installed into office, he will wave his black plume southward, speculated a Texas newspaper. With the army and navy, and the fanatical North, he will invade us. He will use his ukase, enfranchising the Negroes and arming them. He will confiscate property
and commend us to the mercy of torch and steel.
The Richmond Inquirer accused Lincoln of wanting to sink the proud Anglo-Saxon and other European races into one common level with the lowest races of mankind. The Montgomery, Alabama Mail also emphasized the miscegenation theme. If the North chooses to mulattoize itself, that is all right. Let the North be the home of the mixed race, and let the South be the home of the white man, proud of his race and proud of his race's superiority. If Lincoln and his free nigger outrider are elected, we must not submit. We must leave the North with its vile free negroism to shift for itself. Southern men are white men, and intend to continue such. A few realistic Democrats understood that the Republicans had chosen well. A Georgia journalist, J. Henley Smith, thought that the Lincoln-Hamlin ticket is a strong one, which will get up such an amount of courage and effort on their part as will be hard to overcome. A New Yorker sensibly pointed out to Stephen A. Douglas that Lincoln had an advantage because he is little known except by the notoriety you gave him, and there are few prejudices against him. The New Orleans Crescent praised Lincoln for having conducted the 1858 campaign with distinguished ability, and said, "No other man in the state was so capable as himself of encountering the intellectual giant of the Northwest. We regard this nomination as perhaps the strongest the Republican Party could have made." A Kentucky newspaper accurately predicted that there were some things in the personal character and career of Mr. Lincoln which will give him great popularity. Born of humble parentage, and passing the years of his childhood, youth, and early manhood amid the hardships of the backwoods of Kentucky, Indiana, and Illinois, acquiring an education by his own labors as best he could, and gradually working his way to distinction, his life has been one well calculated to excite the admiration and sympathy of voters, most of whom are themselves working men. When to this is added the purity of his private life, the general recognition of which has given him in his own state the sobriquet of Honest Old Abe, we are compelled to admit that the Chicago Convention has nominated the very hardest man to beat it could possibly have given us. Other Democrats agree that Lincoln was the most formidable opponent the Republicans might have chosen. Douglas certainly thought so. When the results of the Chicago Convention reached Washington, he repeatedly said that the nomination of Mr. Lincoln was the strongest the Republicans could have made. But some rejoiced at Lincoln's nomination because they thought he could be defeated. "Next to Seward, we have all earnestly desired Lincoln's nomination," a correspondent told Douglas. "You have beaten him once and will beat him more surely again." The editor of the Chicago Times considered Lincoln weaker than any other candidate before the Chicago Convention. Lincoln's nomination pleased many, though not all, militant opponents of slavery. Frederick Douglass called him a man of unblemished private character with a cool, well-balanced head and great firmness of will, who is perseveringly industrious, one of the most frank, honest men in political life, and a radical Republican, fully committed to the doctrine of the irrepressible conflict. During the campaign of 1858, Douglass remarked, "Lincoln came fully up to the highest remark of republicanism, and he is a man of will and nerve, and will not back down from his own assertions. He is not a compromise candidate by any means." Douglas would eventually support the radical abolitionist party nominee, Gerrit Smith, but he hoped that the Republicans would win. "While I see that the Republican Party is far from an abolition party," he told an upstate New York audience, "I cannot fail to see also that the Republican Party carries with it the anti-slavery sentiment of the North, and that a victory gained by it in the present canvass will be a victory gained by that sentiment over the wickedly aggressive pro-slavery sentiment of the country. I sincerely hope for the triumph of that party." In his autobiography, the black orator said that, "Against both Douglas and Breckinridge, Abraham Lincoln proposed his grand historic doctrine of the power and duty of the national government to prevent the spread and perpetuity to slavery. Into this contest I threw myself with firmer faith and more ardent hope than ever before, and what I could do by pen or voice was done with a will." John S. Rock of Boston, another black abolitionist, also supported Lincoln. A week after the Chicago Convention, Joshua Giddings told his militantly anti-slavery son-in-law, "As to Lincoln, I would trust him on the subject of slavery as soon as I would Chase or Seward. I have been well acquainted with him, and I think I understand his whole character. I know him to be honest and faithful." 7 months later, Giddings said of Lincoln, "I have no doubt that we did the best thing we could when we nominated him." The New York Independent, which had urged the Republicans to choose a militant opponent of slavery like Seward, Chase, Charles Sumner, or Benjamin Wade, praised Lincoln as a true man, a man of great ability, who has thoroughly studied the question of the times, a man honored and beloved by his fellow citizens at home, and one who, if chosen president, will use all his power and official influence to reestablish the Constitution as our fathers made it. Female abolitionists also applauded Lincoln's nomination. Jane Grey Swisshelm deemed him as much of an anti-slavery man as Seward, and said that the rail splitter suited her admirably.
Lydia Maria Child told Charles Sumner, "I don't place much reliance on any political party, but I am inclined to think this Mr. Lincoln is an honest, independent man, and sincerely a friend to freedom."
One thing makes me strongly inclined to like him and trust him. At a public meeting in Illinois 2 years ago, in discussion with Stephen A. Douglas, he said, "A Negro is my equal, as good as I am." Considering that Lincoln came from Kentucky, and that his adopted state, Illinois, is very pro-slavery, I think he was a brave man to entertain such a sentiment and to announce it. Radical Republicans joined the pro-Lincoln chorus.
Senator James R. Doolittle of Wisconsin rejoiced that by nominating Lincoln, he and his allies had created a real Republican Party, no old fogey or conservative party, but one that can march to the logic of events and keep step with the providence of God.
Another Midwestern radical, Senator James W. Grimes of Iowa, was equally enthusiastic.
"The nomination of Lincoln strikes the mass of the people with great favor," he told his wife. "He is universally regarded as a scrupulously honest man and a genuine man of the people."
Lincoln assured Waite Talcott, a leading Illinois abolitionist, that he sympathized with him.
"I know you Talcotts are all strong abolitionists," said Lincoln, "and while I have had to be very careful in what I said, I want you to understand that your opinions and wishes have produced a much stronger impression on my mind than you may think."
Frederick Douglass's candidate, Garrett Smith, publicly criticized Lincoln as too lukewarm an advocate of freedom, but privately he confided to Giddings, "Seward is a very able man, but so also is Lincoln, and he will, I have no doubt, get a greater vote than Seward would have got. I have read in the newspapers what Lincoln said so wisely and sublimely of the Declaration of Independence. I feel confident that he is, in his heart, an abolitionist." Though on principle Smith voted for no one who acknowledged the legality of slavery, he told Giddings that Lincoln's victory at the polls will be regarded as an abolition victory, not less so than if you yourself were elected president. The Boston correspondent of the New York Tribune opined that Lincoln was ahead of the anti-slavery sentiment of the Republican Party, rather than behind it, and therefore to rally round and defend him will be to improve the political morals of the country. Some abolitionists were less enthusiastic. One protested that during the 1858 campaign, Lincoln's ground on the score of humanity towards the oppressed race was too low. Garrett Smith's party adopted a resolution proclaiming that for abolitionists to vote for a candidate like Abraham Lincoln, who stands ready to execute the accursed fugitive slave law, to suppress insurrections among slaves, to admit new slave states, and to support the ostracism, socially and politically, of the black man of the North, is to give the lie to their professions, to expose their hypocrisy to the world, and to do what they can to put far off the day of the slave's deliverance. The party's candidate for governor of New York, William Goodell, condescendingly remarked that if anyone supporting Lincoln called himself an abolitionist, "We know not how to vindicate the sincerity of his professions, except by entertaining a less elevated conception of his intelligence." Goodell sneered that the Republicans had chosen the most available, because the least known, the least prominent, the least distinguished or distinguishable among those to be selected from. A leading member of the party in Ohio said Lincoln ignores all the principles of humanity and the colored race, both free and slave,
And as abolitionists claim the right to freedom of the one class, the political equality to the other, how can they be consistent, to say nothing of honest, in supporting such a man?
Gerrit Smith's agent at his Oswego colony for free blacks scornfully remarked to those urging him to support the Republican ticket, "I should look beautiful voting for a president who would be for sending the marshal after me for helping fugitive slaves to Canada." Equally contemptuous was an Illinois radical who declared, "I hate the Lincoln Party. I would as soon call hell a paradise as to call the Lincoln Party a Republican Party."
Beriah Green, known as Abolition's Axe, indignantly asked how any self-respecting opponent of slavery could possibly support a craven wretch like Lincoln. "He who goes for the Fugitive Slave Bill of 50 hasn't made up his mind that the interstate slave trade should be abolished, is against Negro equality. A man is not to be classified with men, is against the abolition of slavery in the district except on conditions which none but a damned cross between a knave and a fool could either impose or endure."
Other abolitionists, like Stephen S. Foster, denounced the Republican standard-bearer as a man who declared his willingness to be a slave driver general. They also argued that in voting for a slave-catching president, we do as truly endorse and sanction slave-catching as the non-extension policy which he advocates. Lincoln not only stands ready to hunt slaves, but also supports the ostracism, socially and politically, of the blacks at the North. Parker Pillsbury told his fellow radicals,
"In voting for Abraham Lincoln, you as effectually vote for slavery as you would in voting for Stephen A. Douglas."
Swayed by Pillsbury, the Western Anti-Slavery Society denounced Lincoln for being committed to every constitutional compromise for slavery ever claimed by Calhoun or conceded by Webster. The Republican Party was not fit to be entrusted with the interests of humanity and liberty. Oliver Johnson, editor of the National Anti-Slavery Standard, organ of the American Anti-Slavery Society, criticized attacks on Lincoln by men like Pillsbury and Foster.
"Instead of allowing for a fair margin for honest differences of opinion, and thus keeping on good terms with the better portion of the Republicans, the Western Society has selected for special denunciation such men as Sumner, and thereby reduced itself needlessly and recklessly to a small faction of growlers, showing their teeth and snapping just where they should have been generous and conciliatory."
Johnson thought it utterly preposterous to deny that Lincoln's election will indicate growth in the right direction. H. Ford Douglas, an eloquent black abolitionist from Chicago, asked an anti-slavery gathering in Massachusetts,
"If any man can tell me the difference between the anti-slavery of Abraham Lincoln and the anti-slavery of the old Whig Party or the anti-slavery of Henry Clay, who was just as odious to the anti-slavery cause and anti-slavery men as ever was John C. Calhoun. I do not believe in the anti-slavery of Abraham Lincoln, because he is on the side of this slave power."
Douglas alleged that Lincoln in 1858 had refused his request to sign a petition calling for the repeal of Illinois' infamous black laws. He also complained that in 1849, Lincoln introduced on his own responsibility a fugitive slave law for the District of Columbia. Rising from the audience, Massachusetts Senator Henry Wilson challenged Douglas's version of that proposed 1849 statute.
"Mr. Lincoln was born in Kentucky, a slave state, and went to Illinois, and living in a portion of that state which did not entertain the sentiments of this state, Massachusetts, and with a constituency living under what he called the black laws of Illinois, he went into Congress and proposed to make the District of Columbia free. I think that he should be honored for that, and not misrepresented."
Wilson passionately admonished the assembled opponents of slavery,
"When you undertake to arraign men who, in the halls of Congress, before dominating majorities, in a city where public sentiment is against them, where the sneer and the profane word meet them at every step in the streets, are true to the right, I ask you, when you deal with such men, that you shall do them justice, and that if they have done good deeds and brave deeds, that you say it.
Wilson declared that Lincoln was ahead of the anti-slavery sentiment of the Republican Party rather than behind it. No one, Wilson added, ever grew faster in intellectual stature than Mr. Lincoln, from the time he commenced the contest with Douglas to the day he received the Chicago nomination. In addition to Wilson, some other radicals were willing to make allowances for Lincoln. Although the Pennsylvania Anti-Slavery Society chastised him for supporting the Fugitive Slave Act, for opposing citizenship rights for blacks, and for advocating a timid approach to abolition in the District of Columbia, it nevertheless acknowledged that it is due to truth and candor to say that, as between him and his opponents, and on the issues involved in the present contest, the election of Abraham Lincoln will be a great and encouraging triumph. As the campaign wore on, H. Ford Douglas came to regard Lincoln more favorably, reasoning that even if there was little difference between Lincoln and Stephen A. Douglas, there is, in the Republican Party, a strong anti-slavery element, and though the party will do nothing for freedom now, that element will increase, and before long, I trust, springing up from the ruins of the Republican Party will come a great anti-slavery party. So he endorsed Lincoln. Another black abolitionist, John Mercer Langston of Ohio, also supported Lincoln, even though he thought that the candidate's ground on the score of humanity was too low and did him no honor. H. Ford Douglas was not the only radical to criticize Lincoln's 1849 bill to abolish slavery in the District of Columbia. In May, the anti-slavery purist, Wendell Phillips, cited that legislation as justification for calling the Republican standard-bearer the slave hound of Illinois, a knave, a huckster in politics, and a county court lawyer whose only recommendation was that, out of the emptiness of his past, lying newspapers could make him any character they pleased. He paid Lincoln the dubious compliment of being candid. I wish I could say of Mr. Lincoln, as I can of Giddings or Sumner, when I see him swearing to support the Constitution of the United States, I respect him so much that I do not believe he will do what he promises. Curiously, Phillips compared Lincoln unfavorably to Seward, because the latter had enunciated the great philosophical principle of the irrepressible conflict, while the former is merely known as the antagonist of Douglas. Readers of Phillips' Philippic were quick to point out that Lincoln's House Divided address clearly spelled out the same thesis as that of Seward's Rochester speech, delivered 5 months after the rail splitters. Phillips's attack did not go unchallenged. The Connecticut anti-slavery editor Joseph Hawley indignantly protested against it. I know Mr. Lincoln. He is not quite up to my standard, Hawley told the Massachusetts abolitionist orator. But he has always been ahead of his neighbors. He has fought gallantly, honorably, and unselfishly. Phillips's criticism of Lincoln made Hawley feel really insulted, grossly wronged. Applying such savage epithets to Lincoln was worthy of an irresponsible radical like Parker Pillsbury, but not of a gentleman, Hawley declared. A highly esteemed friend and longtime supporter of the New York National Anti-Slavery Standard called Phillips's attack a calumny against Lincoln. The New York Tribune also protested against Phillips's calumnious, unfounded, reckless, and unmanly condemnation of Lincoln's proposal to abolish slavery in Washington. His strictures were a gross misrepresentation that constituted a slander. A fellow Massachusetts abolitionist, Edward Lilly Pierce, gently but firmly disagreed with Phillips, describing Lincoln as an able lawyer, a fair disputant, and an honest man. Pierce asserted that few public men of our time have, in their discourses, treated slavery as a wrong more logically and feelingly than Lincoln. To be sure, he may have a technical record in favor of legislation by Congress for the rendition of fugitive slaves, but so did Seward and John Quincy Adams. The Albany Evening Journal echoed that point, stating that Lincoln's 1849 Emancipation Bill was a project somewhat similar to those which were proposed by John Quincy Adams and Governor Seward, and if there is any more reasonable and practicable way of legislating on the subject at all, we should like to hear it proposed. Considering the community and associations among which he was reared and has lived, Pierce concluded, I think Lincoln stands as well as Seward and Adams do on record. And whatever may have been his technical record, I believe that he himself is right. In September, when anti-slavery radicals gathered in Worcester, Massachusetts, to choose an alternative to Lincoln, Thomas Wentworth Higginson, who styled himself a rather radical Republican, told the convention that he was glad of the excellence of the Republican nominations for president and governor, that is, John A. Andrew, and intended for himself to go for them. Charles Sumner, the most radical anti-slavery member of the U.S. Senate, paid tribute to Lincoln as one whose ability, so conspicuously shown in his own state, attracted at once the admiration of the whole country, whose character no breath has touched, and whose heart is large enough to embrace the broad republic and all its people. Other abolitionists supporting Lincoln included Henry B. Stanton, Eleazar Wright, Theodore Tilton, Sidney Howard Gay, Moncure D. Conway, William H. Burley, John Jay, George Luther Stearns, Richard Hinton, John Wallace Hutchinson, and David Lee Child. The conservative New York Herald predicted that Phillips's speech exposing the inconsistency and insincerity of Honest Abe would seriously hurt the candidate. An Illinoisan reported that radical Republicans in his state find it very hard to support Lincoln on account of his position on the fugitive slave law, slavery in the District of Columbia, the admission of slave states, etc. They think he is not so good as the Chicago platform, and too much like his political progenitor, Henry Clay. Moderate and conservative Republicans were more uniformly enthusiastic about Lincoln. Senator James Dixon of Connecticut, who disapproved of Lincoln's House-divided speech, nevertheless said his was as good a nomination as could have been made, and predicted that he would run well, and as a president he will be capable and incorruptible.
I know him well. He is a man of more than average talents, and as honest as the light of day.
Daniel Ullman, the know-nothing candidate for governor of New York in 1856, praised Lincoln as the true heir of Henry Clay. William L. Dayton of New Jersey declared that, except for slaveholders themselves, he did not believe there was a man in the whole country more conservative in his views on the question of slavery than Abraham Lincoln. Some Northern Democrats also had positive things to say. In New Hampshire, they called Lincoln a man of respectable character and talents, and complimented the Republicans on the improvement they have made over 1856. In neighboring Massachusetts, a Democratic paper remarked that Lincoln's nomination is a strong one and will be difficult to defeat, and those who flatter themselves that the Democrats are to walk over the presidential course with ease will find themselves mistaken. The convention at Chicago has given evidence of shrewdness, no less in the nomination of Mr. Lincoln than in the platform adopted, which is progressive without being ultra. Even some Southerners praised Lincoln. William L. Gogan, a prominent Virginia supporter of Bell, lauded his industry and character. George D. Prentice, editor of the Louisville Journal, described the Republican standard-bearer as a genial, delightful, and high-toned gentleman, whose pleasant hospitality we have enjoyed, and although we think him in great error in some of his political opinions, we have as much confidence in his patriotism as we have in that of any man, except ourselves. A dispatch from Louisville stated that there, Lincoln is liked for his honesty and sincerity, his democratic habits and manners, and his Henry Clay type of character. The New Orleans Bee called Lincoln a man of agreeable manners, a ready and forcible speaker, self-made and self-taught, and personally popular among the burly sons of the West. Douglas also spoke well of his opponent.
Lincoln and I have called each other some pretty hard names on the stump, and I'll do him justice. He is an honest, able, and very popular man. A very clever fellow,
a kind-hearted, good-natured, amiable man. I have not the heart to say anything against Abe Lincoln. I have fought him so long that I have a respect for him. I would not permit, without rebuke, any Democrat to say an unkind or disrespectful word about him." To the Speaker of the U.S. House, the little giant stated, "I have competed with the most distinguished men in the country, and I say the hardest man to beat I ever had to meet in combat was Abraham Lincoln." When it was speculated that the election might be thrown into the House of Representatives because no candidate would win a majority of the electoral votes, Douglas exclaimed, "By God, sir, the election shall never go into the House. Before it shall go into the House, I will throw it over to Lincoln." Lincoln returned the compliment, saying that with Douglas he has had personally only the most friendly relations, for, notwithstanding their public argumentative and political contests, there has never been any quarrel between them. For good measure, he also praised John Bell as an honorable, high-toned gentleman, and Breckinridge as a man of considerable ability, who can make a scathing speech when occasion demands. Formal notification. Lincoln was correct in assessing his wife's enthusiasm about the nomination. As the exceedingly ambitious Mary Lincoln and the rest of Springfield anxiously awaited news from the convention, she said she thought she had more interest and concern in whom the Chicago convention nominated than her husband. A Springfield clergyman believed that Mrs. Lincoln would be so puffed up with pride that she ought to be sent to the Coopers and well secured against bursting with iron hoops. Her childhood dream of becoming First Lady of the land was about to come true. One Springfielder joked about Mrs. Lincoln's ambition, speculating that if Lincoln died before Inauguration Day, she, like another Boadicea, will repair to the White House and assume the reins of government. Mary Lincoln busily prepared for the arrival of the official delegation, which would formally notify her husband of his nomination. Lincoln was not looking forward to the ceremony, which he thought unnecessary. To friends, he complained that he had no idea what to say to the gentleman.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.